Hello, dear listener. Welcome to this forum in which we share our experience and reflections on the language of the Lugara. I am Munguchi Dennis, a trigger. I would like to share with you my experience, my reflections, and my research about this language, which I've done a few years ago. This reflection is combined with my experience of teaching English language in Kabale, Uganda, some time back, and later on in Lodwar, Northern Kenya, and my experience I have had with the students regarding Italian language in Nairobi, Kenya, all put together with my own reflection on the language of Lugara in form of a book. And so we shall be guided in this sharing by a book which has been produced a few months ago. Let's begin directly from the title of this book. The title of the book is A Modern Lugara Tea Grammar Compendium for Everyone. Why this title? A modern. The article A is an indefinite article. For instance, a man, a car, which in Lugara Tea could be azi, aguazi. It indicates that there are many others, but this is singled out from the many. So this means that there are many other ways of presenting grammar of this language. This is one of them. Modern. Why modern? Modern is to designate the period in which this book is written, the period in which you and I speak the language today. Language, like an organism, is a living thing. When put down, it is a living document that grows with time. And so the time in which we speak the language today is much later, after many years, from when the language was first spoken by our earlier ancestors. From that time when our first ancestors spoke the language to today, several periods in its growth, in its development can be designated. One can have different nomenclatures as primordial, formative stage, ancient period, pre-modern, whatever one may decide to designate it. So modern in this title indicates that the current time in which we speak the language, in which the language is put down in form of this book, is modern. Lugara Tea. Why Lugara Tea? This has been one of the main issues where there are different opinions and discussions regarding this language, and a very rich one. From the various opinions, one can identify three schools of thought. The first school holds that the language should be called Lugara, just the way the people are called. The people are called Lugara. The name of the group of people, maybe the tribe, the ethnic group, or what you may call in Lugara Tea, maybe Kari, although Kari carries a different connotation which Lugara really historically didn't have. Kari is kingdom. And if you are very true to the history of Lugara, you will come to realize that Kari is not really something which has been part of Lugara history. So whether you call it Kari, Suru, or in English nation, tribe, or clan, it is Lugara. And so this school holds that much as you call the people, the name of the group of people, the culture Lugara, the language should be called Lugara. The way English is a language of the people who speak that language called English. The second school of thought holds that the language should be called not Lugara, but Lugbari, Lugbari. And the reason is deeply historical. From some of the current researches on the history of Lugara, especially I'm going to quote the one done by Ijoy Lazarus, very tremendous work on the history of Lugara, which we are hoping will be soon out, holds that the people called Lugara today are a group of people who have coined for them an identity from the Kebu, Kaliko, Mlogo, and the Bari. These people who have coined the identity from these four groups of people are called today Lugara. But historically, the name Lugara is derived from a nucleus that belongs to Bari group of people who came from South Sudan. A small nucleus of the people who come from the Bari are called Lugbari, a group of people who today we can bear witness that when you go to Aringa, you will find Lugbari. So according to this tradition, according to this history, the name of the people who have coined for them identity from the other groups, Kebo, Kaliko, Logo, and Bari, came to be Lugbari. because they were more predominant and more influential. And on that regard, according to this school of thought, the language should be called Lugbari. Lugbari. The third school of thought holds that the language should be called Lugbarati, and it is from this that the book picks its title. Lugbarati, to designate that one, Lugbara, as said before, refers to the people, refers to the culture, the people, or the tribe. To make it different, it should be called Lugbarati. T is a dialect, is a tongue, is a language. When added to the stem Lugbara, it becomes Lugbarati. And so when you mention Lugbarati, directly the mind goes to the language, leaving aside the cultural aspect, leaving aside the name of the group of the people, leaving aside the people. Also, in the same line, this line of thought holds that as Lugbari refers to the people also, to make that specific designation to the language, it should be Lugbarati. Of course, language, without disregarding this rich history, grows. Languages adapt, languages get new realities. And since the time the language was called Lugbara, Lugbarati, it has remained predominant today in manuscripts. And for this reason, for this common predominant factor it holds among the three schools of thought, this book has picked the title Lugbarati without disregarding the other two schools of thought, which are rich. So as time goes on, the discussion will go, and as the language grows, definitely we shall arrive at something that holds more meaning and which the rest of people will hold perhaps is the commonest. For the time being, the title the book holds here is Lugbarati. Grammar. Why grammar? A language can be treated from different aspects. Maybe others do the dictionary. One may only pick maybe phonetics, another may pick alphabets, another may pick tenses, another may pick time, different aspects. But this book picks grammar, which compiles most of these aspects apart from dictionary. Grammar basically deals with the rules, the principles that guide a language. Every language has its own grammar. Of course, most human languages all over the globe have certain basics that cut across the domains of different languages. But each language has its own specific aspects that make it peculiar and for which it exists as it is. So the book deals with the grammar of Lugbarati, presenting both the common aspects of grammar and also the specific or the peculiar aspects of the language together as Lugbarati grammar. Compendium. Why compendium? Grammar, or specifically Lugbarati grammar, can be presented in volumes and volumes, big books, main pages. But this one has condensed all these rules, the guiding principles, the paths towards using the words of this language in only 198 pages, or let's say 200 pages. It is a compendium, all the basics, all the essentials of the language. For everyone. Why everyone? Everyone, because you, me, the other, all of us have something to learn from this grammar. Equally, you, me, and the other has something to add for the growth of this grammar. But how do you add if you do not read it? So reading it, accessing it, will help you to see where to add and where to subtract for the growth of this grammar book. So that means basically it is for you, for me, for the other, young, old, highly educated, not highly educated, living in the city, in the village, living currently in Uganda, outside Uganda, living in the ghetto, living in the slum. This language, this grammar is for all of us. Therefore, the title is A Modern Lugbarati Grammar Compendium for Everyone. Let's go to the aim. Why the aim? There is only one aim, and this is the reason. This aim is making Lugbarati easily written, read, and spoken. The reason is, you will agree with me that it's much more easy to speak this language. Very easy, actually. But speaking the language is one thing, and being able to write and read it is another. This is the reason as to why today it's very, very difficult read this language. I don't think anybody can say he or she reads this language perfectly today, just because whatever script we have today of Lugbara is done in grammar which is not of the language. Basically, it has been done in the grammar of two languages. One is Latin at first it was done in Latin, which today is conventionally taken as a dead language in spoken, although in script it is still available. The other language in which most of the scripts of today we have are done is English, perhaps the most predominant. But English has its own grammar, which has really led to slow development of this language. So it's very difficult to write and read this language. This is the aim of this book, to help make Low Bharati easily written, read, and spoken. Objectives. What are the objectives? The objectives are basically four. First, to stimulate interest and research on the language so that the language can come at the center of our communication, and not only orally, even written. We thank God today, with the help of social media today, there is much, much more interest developed in this language, especially by the younger generation. The youth have reached a point today that one may say of consciousness in the language, and not only in the language, in fact, in local identity. There is a high level of consciousness today. If you see what's going on social media, the youth would like to communicate in this language, but then there is the limitation. Grammar, very difficult to write, and there are several ways of writing which causes confusion. So, as objective, the book hopes to stimulate interest in this language so that tomorrow, perhaps, we shall arrive at a common established universal standard in which every script should be measured according to whatever is put down. The second objective is to help those interested in learning and deepening their language, especially those learning this language, and also the non-native speakers. Most of us who speak this language are native speakers. By native speakers, I mean people who learn this language as their first language, even before doing formal education. As the late Father Romano Amafoe used to say, those who suck this language from the breasts of their mothers, it means when you are sucking your mother, you're also sucking some vocabularies if you're a native speaker. The grammar is also to help you, not so much to learn how to speak as such, but to deepen and also to learn the formal aspect of this language. We just speak this language, but really the grammatical aspect, we may not really articulate it. That means this book has as its objective to help those interested in learning and deepening their language, whether they are native speakers or non-native speakers, whether they are young or they are old, like some of us who have grown up speaking this language for many times. Third, to explore the world views or philosophy and values beneath this language. Every language, beneath it, there is a deep philosophy, there is a deep worldview, there is a deep value. In fact, language is a tool to understanding reality. It is this that some belong to the school of thought that reality is conceived and communicated in and through a language. There is no other way. Even other ways of communicating reality, like arts, constructions, songs, riddles, all these are done in language. In fact, I hope one day you try to do this reflection. How do you think? Thinking is done in a language. So if you want to understand the thinking, the deep values, the world views of a group of people, get hold of their language. So for you and me, for the other who wants to learn more about the Low Bhara, whether it's from social, political, economic, or religious, for that matter, the language is key. The last objective of the book is to contribute to a unified growth of the language. The language is still growing. So in this process of its growth, the book aims to contribute something very little. You and me can contribute towards this growth, either by giving ideas directly or by reading and criticizing, saying, no, this is wrong, should have been this way, or add this or remove this. This is a way of helping the language to grow. If you do that, if I do that, we shall have done our part for the future. Let's now go to see what is in this book in terms of its contents. The contents of this book are in five chapters. Chapter 1 deals with sounds and spellings. Under sounds and spellings, we shall see Low Bharati alphabets. How many alphabets does Low Bharati have? And among the alphabets, how many consonants does Low Bharati have? How many vowels does Low Bharati have? Are there some special vowels in Low Bharati? Are there some peculiar consonants in Low Bharati? We are going to see without ending up in the details of those. Phonemes. Phonemes is all about the sound of an alphabet. How are letters sounded in Low Bharati, which is a phonological language, as most of its letters are pronounced the way it is written? There are certain other letters that are not pronounced the way they are written directly. We are going to see this in course of this sharing. And also, under sounds and spelling, we have syllables and stress. Where do you put emphasis in a word? On which letter? On which vowel? The last, the second, on which syllable. Finally, under sound and spellings, you shall see tone and the tonic marks. Where do you put the tonic marks? That will help you to pronounce a word or a letter in a word. Chapter 2 deals with the theme, which is parts of speech. Of course, every word in a complete sentence corresponds to a definite function. A complete sentence in this regard is speech. For instance, when you say, Drusimangamu tauniara, every word in that sentence corresponds to a particular aspect. Maybe subject, maybe verb, maybe postposition. All these are termed parts of speech. And that means in this chapter, we shall have nouns, subject, object, verbs, adjectives, prepositions or postpositions, conjunction, all these. Chapter 3 has the theme tenses, a very big part of every grammar. And in Lubarati, especially in this book, it occupies a very big part. And perhaps this is one of the greatest contributions the book has tried to present in its literature. It has not been easy to construct Lubarati grammar. This one has tried to put a complete grammar. Present tense, past tense, future tense, all the conditional tenses, gerund, imperatives, all the forms of grammar you know, they are there in this book. And we shall see this as we proceed in course of the sharing. Chapter 4 has for its main theme numerals, time, and date. Under numerals, time, and date, we have numbers. How do Lubara count? And we shall see cardinal numbers. For instance, alu, iri, na, su, towi, hazia, hazir, mudnalo, kalina, toralo, alifualo. We shall also see ordinal numbers. For instance, aluzori, irizori, nazori, kalitowizori, kaliaziazori. And then we shall see time. What do Lubara conceive of time? How do Lubara count time? How do they divide time in terms of seasons, days, months? How do you tell time? If Lubara asks you, what is time? Sa, si, or adungare. How do you respond to those two types of communicating time? This is what we are going to see. Then date, of course, the calendar. Chapter 5, which is the last chapter, deals with the common conversations and techniques of conversation. What is conversation? How do you start a conversation in Lubara, first of all? How do you start a conversation? For instance, you are meeting somebody for the first time. How do you begin? Do you just bump into conversation? Or there is a way, there is a formal way, which is formulaic, maybe beginning with the greetings. How do you greet and how do you end conversations? Then introducing people. How do you introduce yourself first? Or how do you introduce somebody? Suppose you meet for the first time. How do you introduce yourself? How do you ask what is your name? Who are you? Where do you come from? This is basically to help those non-native speakers in a way. And then finally, under that theme, we have expressing sentiments and feelings. For instance, Lubara, when Lubara is happy or wants to thank somebody, thank you. How does Lubara say? Award four meaning, award four sorrow, a 1 year. Or you want to express feelings of anger or annoyance or exclamation. How do you say, I am sorry? How do you express wonder? What you say in English, oh my God, oh. How do you put these things in Lubarati? That's what expressing sentiments and feelings deals with. These are the 5 chapters contained in this book. And as a final remark for this first sharing, which is the introduction to this book, I would like to, first of all, acknowledge many, many people whose ideas have helped so much in shaping this book. I mean, I can't mention all. They are all in the bibliography. But I would like to cite two more names here. First, J.P. Krasolora, who wrote A Study of the Lubara in Brackets Mali Language, 1960. I want to thank Lubarati Language Board members because I have used their revised Lubarati Orthography Guide 2013. A very small pamphlet but has helped a lot in this book. I also want to thank Mr. C. Obea, whose manuals helped a lot in this book. I want to thank Father Romano Amafua of Happy Memory. His manual, which I accessed through Father Rufino Ezama, thank to him too, has helped a lot also to shape my reflections on this language. I want to thank Matua Asumi for his dictionary, which and very soon will be available for consumption. So you can already see there is a lot going on. The future is very promising as far as this language is concerned. It is your responsibility, my responsibility, to help this language grow. In my own small way, in your own small way, this language will definitely grow. Finally, I want to say two things. First, to you, the listener, thank you for taking your time. Thank you for listening. I would like to ask you, please, make some contribution in terms of comment. Tell me this is wrong, this is right, remove this, add that. How will it be this way? Especially when we enter into treating what is in this book. The other last word I want to say to you is that thank you for your time. This is just but a beginning. Be blessed.